good to be here this morning. Amen. Praise the Lord. We're going to do some renovating with the choir as soon as we possibly can. Got to come up with some kind of so they can all get in it, okay? And we need more, okay? We need more in the choir, and the more the better, all right? You know, when you get to heaven, you're going to sing a lot. So you need to practice down here, all right? That's why it's good to sing in the congregation, too. Oh, it's going to be a great day. I just feel the presence of God already. I trust you feel his presence. He's here, you know. Amen. Let him speak to you. He really will if you let him. See him. See him today in the songs we sing. And listen to him as he speaks to you through the Word of God and through the Holy Spirit. He sure wants to do that. All right. Well, let's pray. Then we'll have our first congregational song. Our Heavenly Father, we sure thank you today for loving us so much and being so good to us. Thank you for your presence in the building today. For God, if you don't meet with us, we meet in vain. But Lord, I'm so glad we have your presence today with us and in us. And I pray, dear God, if there be one in the building today who's not yet saved, Lord, that before the day is done, they'll call upon you with a repentant heart and believe in the Lord Jesus Christ. Bless all that goes on. We love you, Lord, because you first loved us. And we do it all this morning in thy precious name. Amen and amen. All right, what number we got? 191. Let's stand. 191.
Stand and turn over to page 258. Oh, how I love Jesus. Amen.
seated. Those are two wonderful songs. We have been blessed. And, you know, even when you think about, you know, about count your blessings, and sometimes you look at your life, you say, what blessings, preacher? And we all have those days and times, but I shared this with a Sunday school class. Kevin was telling me about it. He and Jenny, the Sparks family that was here with us just in our missions Sunday, Mrs. Sparks' mother was killed this past week in a highway accident. And so hope that you'll be praying for her family, okay? You never know when your life may be over here or someone close to you. But it's good to know that you're saved and they're saved. David's little baby died, and he said, that baby can't come to me, but I can go to him. Amen? And so I'm thankful that I've got loved ones in heaven. All right, Mrs. Baker, you know, of course, you know her mother passed away in the first part of the year. And she still has some tears about that. But in those tears, she talks to her mama now more than she ever talked to her in her life. And her mother's not even here. She talked to her. Hello, mama. Hello, Sherry. I mean, it's a conversation between them two. Okay? Sometimes I say, honey, you going to talk to me? She says, no, I'm talking to mama right now. I'm thankful that we know the Lord. All right, here's a thank you note from Mrs. Alice Lyons and her family. And, of course, you know that Brother Lyons went to be with the Lord just a little over a week ago. Words cannot express our feelings of love and compassion shown to our family in the loss of Howard. Everything was done in such a beautiful way. He loved his family, he loved his church, but most of all, he loved his Lord. His purpose in life was to lead people to our Savior. Howard's jail ministry was so important to him, and buying Bibles in his name for the prison was such an honor. He fought a good fight and is now reaping his rewards. Continue to pray for our family as now our Christian warrior is in heaven. Thank you so much for all the prayers, the visits, the phone calls, and food that was prepared for our family. Our church family made our loss so much easier. I know you all will continue to pray and support us. Love in Christ, Alice Lyons and children. And so she's sitting right there. And we did. They always needed Bibles for the prison ministry. Brother Lyons headed that up. And two other men, Kevin, one, and another gentleman, Brother Garvin, those three went every Tuesday to the prison. And now we're going to be getting Bibles and putting in there in the Bible that the Bibles were given in memory of Mr. Howard Lyons. So we got some more money came in today, and some came through the mail. Over $500 have come in to buy Bibles. And so that'll be a blessing to him and to the Lord, okay? All right, let me see. We got some announcements to make, and I'll try to go through as quick as I can. We got baptism at the church this morning. Got one to be getting baptized, so it won't be long to take care of that. All right, next Sunday, we'll be voting on the Christian Man of the Year, and we'll present that award on Father's Day, which is 2 weeks away. And I do not remember what gentleman won it last year. Is he here? Who? Chris? How did Chris win? No. Chris Malfus was the selection last year. And he's a fine gentleman, loves the Lord. And I feel sure qualified to get that. And so Chris and I will count the votes next Sunday. So you can prepare to do that, all right? And it's good to have Bob and Marie Ford here today. Brother Bob's going to be preaching this morning and tonight. Had a great Sunday school class that he helped us with. Brother James said a while ago, he said, man, if I don't do something to you, something's wrong with you. I said, you're right, Brother James, you're exactly right. All right, let's see here. We got the Low Country Baptist Fellowship is tomorrow up in Lexington at the Gethsemane Baptist Church. And it's in Lexington. Brother Steve Wilson's a pastor there. It'll be a great meeting later in the month, the last Sunday of the month through Wednesday. Brother Benny Beckham will be with us preaching. Dr. Beckham will be here. How about that? And he got married this past Monday, I think it was, got married. He said, you tell Miss Baker her prayers have been answered. When Brother Benny's first wife passed away, Sherry said, now we got to find you another wife. He said, oh, no. I'm not ready for that. So it's been over 10 years now. And a lady out in California, never been married, they met out there and just met, and that's how they met. And nothing don't happen. They'll be here, and we'll get to meet his wife, okay? Bible school, we're going to have a Bible school meeting next Sunday night after church and getting things going for Bible school. I'll tell you more about that, okay? All right. Well, also today we want to honor one of our high school graduate. Where's Brother Dylan? Brother Dylan Lamb. Dylan, do you want to come on up here, Brother Baker? We've got you, Brother. Some of you, the choir didn't hear this, but Dylan was up here messing with something, and we had something went crazy. It just, and everybody was, is it a fire alarm or we're being under attack? Dylan had to run back there and fix it up. I told Brother Ford, I said, that's our way of getting folks woken up for church. And it does a real good job. What happened?
I have no idea.
You have no idea. The PA man has no idea what went on, but he fixed it real quick. Dylan graduated from high school this year. A honor roll. Valedictorian, but he can't run the PA system. No, he does a superb job in the PA system. Amen. And Dylan, I know you probably got a good Bible, but you never have too many good Bibles. Now, this Bible come from your people, okay? And I chose this Bible because of what it says in the front concerning the King James Bible. So it may answer a lot of questions you have of how the King James Bible came to us, how God was in it. But we're thankful for you. We're thankful for your family. We really are. You grew up here, and you have grown up too. I just when I look at you and your family, I'm thankful that God's give you a great heritage. A great mom and dad and grandparents in the Lord. And I was going to read to you what we wrote in here. It says, Dylan Lamb, high school graduation, Welch Creek Baptist Church, James Baker, pastor, the day's date. Dylan, always hold dear to your heart the Word of God. Read it each day. Rest upon it in life. Rely upon it when you need instructions. When obeyed, this book will be the key to success in your Christian journey. May the Lord Jesus Christ bless you as you serve him, Pastor Baker, and your friend.
Say something. I said, say something. He said, thank you.
This is the valedictorian. Thank you. Now, he gave a speech that night, and it was a good one, too, but do you want to say anything?
Thank you all.
Thank y'all. God bless you. Let's give him a big hand. Yeah, he gave a rare but very, very unusual speech, and I thought, well, that he's put some thought in that thing. And you got to be smart to be valedictorian. You know that? You just cannot be a dummy. Okay? Somebody said, what? There was 99 graduated my high school class, 99. Somebody said, what number were you? I said, I'll put it this way, it wasn't in that top 10. Okay? And I was probably down there, you know, in that area where it says, you know, you got about that much, you know, the water's that deep, and it's almost to your nose. I barely got out, all right? But that's okay. The Lord's blessed me over the years with a wife who is educated. Sing for us, choir.
Thank you.
together just for a few moments. Oh, yeah. Make sure your name's written down. That's good. Argentina greetings. You know, saw them ladies hugging. We found out last week in Argentina, over there, if you shake hands, that's an insult. You got to hug and kiss on the cheek. We don't do that here. Okay? We shake hands. You folks act like saved people out there shaking hands and fellowshipping. All right. Well, Smarlinick over here, Mr. Fisher come by and said the reason that Sherry talked to her mother instead of me is because her mother would listen. I'll make a motion, we vote Rick out. Is there a second? Yes, ma'am. Sherry's making a second. She made the second. She raised her hand. I mean, you give her a comment, she votes you out. Okay. Oh, yeah. Yeah, Brother Hensley's not doing well. Matter of fact, his wife called yesterday and said he could pass away today. And so we need to pray. Okay? All right, any birthdays this past week? I know we got one, at least one. There she is. You recognize that, don't you? She's got her birthday stuff out. I love it. Are you the only one? Anybody else have a birthday? Oh, Miss B. Where's your little hat? Nobody gave you one. Okay. Uh-huh. Well, here we are. Miss B, when was your birthday?
Wednesday.
And when was your birthday? Today. Isn't that wonderful? Uh-huh. Now, listen. I've got money in each pocket. Which pocket you want, left or right? Huh? Right? I said, which pocket do you want, left or right? I kept going.
Well, that is her right. That's her right.
Oh, that's your right.
Her right.
It's my left. So which one you want now? The left. She gets that after her daddy. Okay. You sure you want the left pocket, this pocket? You do? Okay, there it is.
pocket you want?
I guess the other one.
You guess the other one? Well, it might be something that's in his pocket over here. That's empty. I hate to tell you that. It's empty. Well, there's yours.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay?
Thank you.
And let's sing happy birthday to him. Here we go. Ask her what her age was. She just walked off the platform. Amen. Yeah, if you only knew how old she was, you wouldn't be laughing. Now, B is a sweet lady, and we love her, don't we? Sure we do. Praise the Lord. All right, then birthdays just keep coming, don't they? About every year we get one. All right. I think about this as the first Sunday in June, back in 1977, I came here the first Sunday in June, and I met over there in the Sunday school building back in 1977. I forget who it was that called and said, "Mr. Baker, we don't have a preacher. We need somebody to come just supply, fill in until we find one." So I came over, filled in. And been feeling it ever since. And so anyway, somebody said something. They're still looking. And Tommy here said, Brother Ford said he got some folks he going to send down here. So, of course, you can't believe Tommy. Yeah, when he's talking about the preacher anyway. And how many years is that, 38 years? 37, 38 years. And I was 27. Miss Baker was 25. And well, God's been good to us, hasn't he? Has been, is good to us, and has and still is, and we give him glory for that. Amen. All right. Well, we're going to receive our tithes and offerings. But before we do that, I want to make sure that you turn in your faith promise mission cards today if you haven't already turned it in. I hope that each of you have been inspired enough. You raised your hand the last 2 weeks. I'm going to increase. I'm going to add to mine. And we've had several turned in. I don't know exactly how many. If you do not have a card, there's some in the foyer. You be sure to get that and turn it in tonight or as soon as possible. You can give them to me or give them to our church treasurer, but I'd like to know. Okay, do not put your name on it. The only thing on there is what you're currently giving. If you are... If not, you put on there what you're going to start giving. But if you are giving, you put down what you're currently giving and what you're going to add to that, what you're going to increase it to. Brother Ford mentioned that in Sunday school about increasing. And our increasing with our giving can help increase getting the gospel out. Increase more people getting hearing the gospel and getting saved. A great lesson. Okay? All right. We're going to sing a couple of verses of the song and receive this morning's offering.
All right, let's all stand once again. Turn to page 267, 267, first and last. Amen.
Yeah.
Well, down here, right in front of me, is Brother Raymond Craven. He was here when I got here. He was already here, he and his wife and his children. And I just can't tell you the times that he and his wife have come to my rescue, not in things that are, but just little things that I needed some help and direction with, encouragement. And sometimes Raymond could be a little bit gruff. Amen? Some of you men out there are just like him. You're a little bit gruff. That don't mean that you're mean. It just means you, that's just the way it is. But underneath all that is a tender heart, a heart that cares. Amen. Brother Raymond, would you ask God bless the offering? Yes. Yes. Amen. 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 Beautiful, isn't it? I tell you what, sure appreciate Miss Ruth and Miss Betty, the great job they do on the organ and the piano. Well, we've been announcing this for the last several weeks about our mission emphasis, and the Lord would work it out to where Brother Bob Ford could come and be with us. And when they were here at camp meeting, I asked him, I said, Brother Bob, he'd been so sick and tied up and couldn't get away. I won't go into all the surgeries he's had, but he's had over how many? 94. And we're not talking about minor surgeries either. Most of them very major, serious. More than one time, the doctors have told his wife, we just not sure if he's going to live or die in this and here. But the Lord has given him life and blessed him. He's still here. And we thank God for that. And so I asked him, I said, if you're able, could you come sometime and be with us? And he said, well, Brother Baker, I'll have to look and see. So he called me up and said, I've got June the 7th open. That's about it. And I said, well, come on. And so it worked out perfectly since the last 2 weeks. We've been emphasizing missions. And so I don't know how many years we've been supporting he and the Bearing Precious Seed, but it's been a good while now. And we sure love him. I love being around him. I love being around his wife and just a sweet spirit, good spirit. And but we're glad to have you, Brother Ford, Miss Ford. Good having both of you here. Hope you've enjoyed your stay over in that little guest house and comfortable. Stay as long as you want, okay? As long as you're out by Friday. And I'm just teasing. All right, this is Brother Bob Ford. He's with Bearing Precious Seed, Bible Printing Ministry. He's going to come and preach to us this morning. And he'll be here again tonight, too. That's going to be exciting. Amen. Brother Ford, it's good having you back.
Good to be here.
Praise the Lord. Amen. God bless you.
It is a joy to be with you today. If you will, be opening your Bibles to the book of the Psalms, chapter 42. We've been in the Bearing Precious Seed work a little over 39 years. And God's been so good to us.
Is it not on? Yes, it is. It's on. It's on. Well, how about now? Now.
Talk. Is it on? It's on now? Okay.
Y'all gotta quit messing with it.
Now, if I can get it back in the pocket. Okay. It is a joy to be with you. I enjoyed the camp meeting this year. I don't know anybody puts on a camp meeting better than you folks. And the MC is just something else. I'm telling you, he's such a blessing. And you keep this place so beautiful and so neat. And I thought, well, the grounds are so good. The church is always beautiful. The tabernacle's always beautiful. I wonder what the house is like. My goodness gracious. You can't find a hotel or motel room looks as nice as that house. And bed that sleeps as good as the bed. And beautiful bathrooms. And wow. I'm telling you, we really don't want to leave, but we got to leave tomorrow. But I told my wife, I said, why don't we just move in here? You know? Better than what we got. But no, we appreciate it so much, and I love you, preacher. He's such a blessing, and thank you for supporting our family over 20 years. We're so grateful for that, and the blessing you've been to us, and the camp meeting's been to us, and your faithfulness supporting our family and the ministry of Bearing Precious Seed. And God is blessing our ministry. This year we're emphasizing 4 countries. Now, we help missionaries in over 100 countries. We've printed hundreds of millions of Bibles for the mission field. And this year, we're emphasizing places like Nagaland. Who's ever heard of Nagaland? Well, in India, you know how India is shaped and comes down? There's a little piece that runs off over here. That's Nagaland. They've never had a Bible in their language in the history of the world. And we provided them with the John Romans. And they started 50 churches from John Romans.
Wow.
And then we got the New Testament this year, and they're beside themselves. And they've asked us to hurry up and get the whole Bible, which our translators are working on. We've got translators in the 1040 window in different places around the world working day and night to get the Word of God translated into languages. We try to do anywhere from 2 to 5 new languages every year. There's some 3,000 languages that do not have one word of the Word of God in their language yet. So the need is tremendous, and we do need more translators, and we're training translators. But Nagaland is right in the middle of a lot of closed nations. They're closed to us for the most part, not totally, but these Indians can get in there that are in Nagaland, and they are burdened to do it. We've been sending our men over to train them, and we train them for 1 to 2 months straight, 12 hours a day, 6 days a week. That's the way they like it. They can't get enough of it, and they want to share the Word of God everywhere they go. And they're burdened about China. Nagaland's right here. China's up here. Nepal's over here, Bhutan's right here, Bangladesh here, and Myanmar, formerly Burma, is right over here. And those are five nations that are hard for Americans to get into and do much of anything. But these Indians can get in there and do all kind of things. And they're excited about it. They've been going in. They've already planted 10 churches, and they hope to plant 100 churches in the next 2 years. And we're training some 200 of them at present, but there's more coming all the time that want training. So pray for Nagaland. And then another country they're begging for more scriptures from is Guyana. Now, how many of you know what's famous about Guyana? Jim Jones. He slaughtered 920 people, something like that there. And but in Guyana, the Islamic crowd, the Muslims, are coming in and trying to establish the Muslim religion and take over there. And they're trying to do that all over the world, but they're trying to do it in Guyana. Guyana is the only English-speaking country in all of South America. And they are begging us. There's some 50 national pastors and missionaries besides that that are begging us to come in. Altogether, there's some 100 that we'll be working with to try and reach that country. They've asked for 100,000 John Romans to start with, around 50,000 New Testaments and 10 to 30,000 Bibles. And they desperately need the Word of God to stop the Muslim influence. And the capital city of Georgetown, Guyana, has 400,000 people. And they want us to hold a citywide crusade and try and reach that city and establish that, because that's where most of the people are. They're just short of 1 million people in the whole country, but 400,000 of them are right there in Georgetown. And so they want to establish some 100 new churches. So pray with us that we'll be able to raise the funds to supply them with the 10 to 30,000 whole Bibles, the 25,000 New Testaments, and the 100,000 John and Romans. And then Poland. We've got some open doors in Poland that are unbelievable. And Polacks need the Word of God too, amen. There's some fellas there that are on fire for God that are doing something. And they want Bibles. They want some 30,000 whole Bibles. So pray for us in that endeavor. And then Liberia. Liberia is a country we're emphasizing this year. Now, you know, Liberia is a country that's been devastated. Though it was in good shape when the United States helped found it and get it going, but we turned it over to the nationals, and then this government came in and the military took over and just about destroyed the place and killed people. There are more orphans per capita in Liberia than any place on earth. And the Ebola virus is there, and people are dying. But there are some nationals and a few missionaries there that say there has never been a time, though it's a Muslim religion, is big there, but they say there's never been a time when more Muslims and more people are open to the gospel than right now, because what they've got is not helping them. So please pray as we work there. I was in a little church in Georgia, and I preached there that morning. I told about the need, and after I got through, the pastor said, how much is a truckload of paper? I said, $20,000. He said, oh. He said, how much we got in missions? Now, this is a church that had about 80 people there Wednesday night, but they run about 120, but the auditorium only holds about 80 people, and they really need a new auditorium bad. And so when the other 40 come in, they put out chairs, and some of them even stand around because they can't get enough chairs out. And so they stand on out and listen best they can, the younger people. And he said, well, we don't have enough. We only have 12,000 admissions. That won't do. He said, how much we got in the building fund? They said, 20,000. He said, how many of you want to give the 20,000 to buy a truckload of paper? Every hand in the auditorium went up, and they bought a truckload of paper. And I thought, here they are, people standing around, chairs put out, and they give all the money in their building fund. Now, they've got the 10 acres. There's just nothing on it, but, and they need a building. So pray for those poor folks. They just gave everything they had. And I was up in Brother Ed Parton's church, which you folks know real well, in Pigeon Forge. And Brother Ed said, Brother Bob, thank you for the sermon, and we really enjoyed that. He said, when a member dies, he said, we do something. He said, you've come at the right time. We do something for the Word of God. And I thought, well, I didn't mean to come when somebody died, but it was the right time. He said, we do something for the Word of God. And they bought a truckload of paper. And so pray for us. We need more truckloads of paper, but a roll of paper costs $625. And in the camp meeting, your wonderful people gave, and the people that were here, left here, gave to help us buy more than a roll of paper. And we can't thank you enough. You folks are such a blessing to so many. And how can you thank a people like you? You're an amazing people. And it's Marie and I are just thrilled to just be in your presence. We hope to glean a lot from you, and hope some of you will rub off on us. Amen. Now, in Psalm chapter 42, I'm going to start reading in verse 1. As the hart panteth after the water brooks, so panteth my soul after thee, O God. My soul thirsteth for God, for the living God. When shall I come and appear before God? My tears have been my meat day and night, while they continually say unto me, where is thy God? When I remember these things, I pour out my soul in me. For I had gone with the multitude, I went with them to the house of God with the voice of joy and praise, with a multitude that kept holy day. Why art thou cast down, O my soul, and why art thou disquieted in me? Hope thou in God, for I shall yet praise him for the help of his countenance. O my God, my soul is cast down within me. Therefore will I remember thee from the land of Jordan and of the Hermonites from the hill of Mizar. Deep calleth unto deep, at the noise of thy waterspouts, all thy waves and thy billows are gone over me. Yet the Lord will command his loving kindness in the daytime, and in the night his song shall be with me, and my prayer unto the God of my life. I will say unto God my rock, why hast thou forgotten me? Why go I mourning because of the oppression of the enemy? As with a sword in my bones, mine enemies reproach me, while they say daily unto me, where is thy God? Why art thou cast down, O my soul, and why art thou disquieted within me? Hope thou in God, for I shall yet praise him who is the health of my countenance and my God. Let's pray. Our Father, we thank you for the Word of God. I thank you for Welch Creek Baptist Church and Pastor Baker and Mrs. Baker. I thank you for these people, Lord. What a blessing they are. And they're a blessing to so many of us. And Lord, it's just a privilege to be in their presence and to be able to speak from this pulpit where this man of God so faithfully preaches the precious word. Now, Lord, would you honor your word today? And Holy Spirit, would you speak to our hearts and give us ears to hear what the Spirit of God would say to us, and help us to be what we need to be in this world that would get us down and discouraged and despondent. And Lord, we need you. We need you more than anything. And Lord, we're never going to reach a world for Christ unless we're filled with the Spirit of God and we have you all over us. And Lord, we need your presence this morning. And I pray that when this day is done, we would have said it's been good to be in the house of God. And Lord, I pray if anyone's lost today, please save them. For we Christians, help us to grow in our faith and in our knowledge of you. Because the more we get to know you, the more we'll know what life is all about and what we should be doing each and every day for you. In Jesus' name I ask it. Amen. Amen. Now, this psalm is a psalm written to the chief musician, Maschil, and it's for the sons of Korah. Now, if you'll remember the name Korah, Korah was a man that led a rebellion against God's man, Moses. And Korah led 250 people against Moses. They wanted to run things instead of him. And when you go against the man of God, you're ultimately going against the plan of God, and you're going against God himself, because God's appointed that man. and he had appointed Moses. And they thought they could handle things and take over things and take the will of God away. But God created a new thing in the earth. He opened up the earth and swallowed them up. And they died. Now, the sons of Korah didn't follow in their daddy's shoes. You know, you don't have to be a product of your environment.
No.
You don't have to be like your parents. You don't have to be like your peers. You don't have to follow in with the peer pressure and those that would have you to be what they are. You can be what you want to be. And the sons of Korah learned from the mistakes of their father. And they dedicated themselves as songwriters and singers in the temple.
Amen.
And so you can dedicate yourself, and you don't have to be like your daddy or your mama or those around you that try to influence you for evil, for bad.
Yeah.
Now, in this psalm, though, there's something wrong. This man has become discouraged. He's displeased. He's despondent. He's despairing. He's distressed. And why is he down in the dumps? Why is he complaining so much? Well, number one, we find that he's absent from the presence of God. Now you say, well, God's omnipresent. You can't be absent from the presence of God. Well, he is absent from God working in his life. And in verses 1 and 2, it says, as the heart panteth after the water brooks, so panteth my soul after thee, O God. Now, a lot of preachers preach this, and it's good preaching. They preach on how that little heart, that little red deer is running, and the dogs, the hunters are after him, and the devil's after us, and we're running from the devil, you know. And we come and we get refreshed from that brook. And the brook's the word of God, the washing of the water by the word. And we drink of the brook and we can go on and keep away from the devil and the hunters that are after us. And that sounds good. But this guy is running from God. And in verse 2 it says, my soul thirsteth for God, for the living God. When shall I come and appear before God? He is not in the presence of God. He's not appearing before God. Look at verse 6. Oh my God, my soul is cast down within me. Therefore will I remember thee from the land of Jordan. He's not in Israel where he ought to be. He's in Jordan. And of the Hermonites, there's the mountains, the Hermonites. They're a series of mountains, and the largest, Mount Hermon. And the hill of Mizar is right below Mount Hermon. And it's a prominent hill there. And that's where he is. He is not in Israel. I don't know if he left where God wanted him for a good paying job. I've seen people do that.
Right.
They don't find a good church, but they got a good paying job. And I don't know if he was trying to get away from things. I don't know exactly why he's there. But he has left Israel and where God was working in his life. And he has some problems here, and he's got so discouraged and so down, and he just can't seem to get up. And there's two things that must be present in your life and my life if we're going to develop spiritually.
That's right.
Now, the first thing is personal individual development. And that comes from Bible reading, Bible study, Bible obedience, Bible memorization, and prayer. You've got to be in the Word of God, knowing the Word of God, living the Word of God, and you've got to be praying if you're going to develop spiritually.
Come on, preacher.
That's why when we have our Faith Promise Mission Conference, we spend time in prayer. We start praying 2 months ahead of time. We have people that are on the altar 2 weeks before the conference, 24 hours a day on their knees. Now, sometimes there's a crowd there. People pick different times of the day, but every 15 minutes there's somebody there. And they'll pray for around 15 minutes, then they leave, somebody else comes. And maybe two somebodies or three somebodies. Our church runs over 1,000, so we may have several. But 24 hours a day, we're praying, we're begging God, because we want to reach a world for Christ. Because it's business.
Yes, it is.
It's God's
Amen.
Business. And it's God's heart.
Yes, preacher.
And sure, shouldn't God's greatest concern be our greatest concern?
Yes, sir, preacher.
And so we pray. And so here, Bible reading and prayer is so important. And then we need corporate development, not just personal individual, but corporate development. And that comes from being present in the local church
yes.
under the teaching of the teachers that God has placed here to teach you and to preach to you. You need that development. And when the evangelists come, when the missionaries come, when the special speakers come, God is sending people to help develop us. And so we need that. Now, he's absent from the presence of God. That's the first thing. Number two, the reason he's down in the dumps and so distressed and depressed is he was taunted by unbelievers. Look at verse 3. My tears have been my meat day and night while they continually say unto me, where is thy God? Now, competition in that day wasn't just in sports. It was in whose God is the best God. Now, you know why God sent Moses into Egypt? To show who was the best God. You see, the Egyptians worshiped 10 different gods. They worshiped Baal. They worshiped Molech. They worshiped Ashtaroth. They worshiped Hophni and Apis and Osiris and Iris and Newt and Men and other gods. They worship several different gods. And someone may say, look at you, you're down in the dumps. God's not blessing you. Where's your God? Look at my God. My God's Baal. He's the God of fertility. And look at my fields, how they're producing crops. My crops are just growing like crazy. There's just an abundance of fruit on my trees and my crops. And look at my animals. Look at my cattle. Look at my sheep. Look at my goats. Look at my donkeys. Look at them. They are flourishing because of my God is Baal, and he's a God of fertility, and he has made everything so fertile. But what is your God doing? Look at you. Why'd you have that accident? Why is your car broken down? Why can't you get a good job? Why can't you make any money? Why are you sick all the time? Why have you had 94 surgeries? Why are you fixing to have cancer surgery June 24th and then three more major surgeries, replace my ankles and some bones and things, ligaments. There might be a ligament in my leg, I don't know. There's all kind of stuff they put in there. So I look for a part of a ligament and part of a tendon, and it's a ligament, you know. They did take five tendons one time and made me a ligament. So I guess if that would be a ligament, wouldn't it? Five, ten. So, but anyway, but they say, why are you sick all the time? You know, sometime when things are going wrong, they might be going right.
That's a good statement.
I was in the hospital, and I went into a coma, and they didn't think I was going to come out of the coma, and I found out that a preacher came to see me. He's discouraged, and he had 50 people, and all 50 of them didn't seem to like him too much, and they were giving him a hard time. When he preached the truth, they didn't like it. And he came and he shared his heart with me. I'm in a coma. I don't know what's going on. And he shared his heart with me, you know. And I started preaching. That's what they tell me. I don't know what I said, but evidently it was good because he got right with God and went back. And they're running 500 now. And he's on top of the world. But I also won two nurses to the Lord in the coma. And one day I came out of the coma. And there's this little nurse there, just a sweet little thing. And I said, hi, little lady, how you doing? And she jumped back. She said, you've out of the coma. I didn't know I'd been in it. I just thought I woke up. And I said, I guess so. I said, but you know something? Your mom and dad can kick you out of your home. And your fiancé can run off with your best friend. But there's a friend that sticks closer than a brother, and his name is Jesus. And she says, ah, and runs out of the room. And I thought, well, that didn't go over too good, you know. And a little while later, the head nurse comes in and she says, well, while you were in the coma, you were a blessing. said, now you're out and you're a curse. She said, you just hurt that little girl to no end. I said, what did I do? She said, her mom and dad are millionaires. They wanted her in the millionaire business with them. And she wanted to help people. So she became a nurse. And now she's going to school to be a doctor. But she's doing her nursing while she's studying to be a doctor. And said, her fiancé, that's another one studying to be a doctor, just ran off with her best friend who's a nurse. And said, how'd you know all that? I said, I don't know anything about that, but must have been God. She said, God wouldn't do that. I said, well, I don't know. I didn't mean to hurt her feelings. But a little while later, near the end of the shift, second shift, she came in and she grabbed my hand. And she said, preacher, I need that friend that sticks closer than a brother. And she knelt beside my bed and received Christ as her Savior. And now she and her husband are medical missionaries in Africa. So, you see, when everything looks like it's going wrong, it might be going right. So I look at every surgery as an opportunity, every time I'm in the hospital, every time I'm in the doctor's office, as an opportunity for good and not bad. You know, I remember one time I wasn't responding, so they rushed me out. And they tried to bring me back to life and everything. It was like I was up here looking down on everything. And then the one big doctor, he says, well, that's it. We can call it. And they called it and pronounced me dead. And then they went to move me from one gurney to the other gurney to wheel me out. And they dropped me between the two tables. And God said, they don't know how to bring him back, but I do. Whap! And knocked a big knot on my head, bruised up my back, but my heart started beating again, brought me back to life. And so here I am, you know. But, you know, you can get down awful easy. And this guy gets down. But, you know, I like to stay, instead of depressed, I like to stay impressed with Jesus. So I like to stay in the Word of God and hang on to the Word. But this guy is taunted by unbelievers. Why are you having financial trouble? Why are you having problems? See, they don't understand that sometime when you lose a loved one or when you go through hell on earth, so to speak, that God is going to use that to refine you and to develop you and to make you more like his son. Jesus didn't have a bed of roses on this earth, and we haven't been promised that either. But we can enjoy the ride while we're here, no matter how rough it gets, if we'll look to the right place. Now, let me say a third thing. The reason he was down and depressed, he was haunted by the memory of better days. Look, if you will, at verse 4. When I remember these things, I pour out my soul in me. For I had gone with the multitude. I went with them to the house of God with the voice of joy and praise with the multitude that kept holy day. He's remembering back when he went with the multitude to church. Man, they were having a time. They were shouting it out. The preacher was preaching. They were just having a ball. He was enjoying serving God and enjoying the service that God had given, the music, everything. He went there on the holy day. And every day is a holy day today.
That's right.
And this is a holy day we're in. You know, that's where some people live, in the good old days. They're not doing anything this day but being depressed and trying to depress others. We're not living in the days of the Texas tornado anymore, where they come into town and the Billy Sundays and the town goes dry and everybody gets saved and everybody comes to the meeting. And, you know, we just don't seem to have the Spurgeon atmosphere anymore. But, you know, I remember Pastor Baker when I was pastoring in Tennessee. I was out on visitation. I ran into a man that had been the head deacon at Jack Hiles Church. But his job, he had a chance to become superintendent of this big plant where I was pastoring in that town. And so he left Jack Hiles Church to come there. Now, he visited around and we got him to come to our church once, but he just couldn't settle on a church. So he just stayed home. And I'd say, you know, you need to be in church. You need to be doing what you did up there. He said, well, it's not the same. All these churches are so small. They don't have everything we had. They don't do everything we did. We don't have a Dr. Howells. I said, well, I'm back then, Dr. Howells was always going with his throat and everything. I said, well, I'm not going to do that for you. And I said, but I'll preach the gospel. I'll preach the word of God to you. And we could use you, if you were such a great soul winner up there and a head deacon, we sure could use you to be a soul winner and help us here. But no, he would go back to Dr. Howells' church and they'd have him up and he'd lead in prayer. They even let him teach Sunday school and do some special things and just made big fanfare over him. But he was not doing a thing to serve God at all. And some people live in that way. They live in the past. But you know, God still saves.
Yes, he does.
God still calls. God's not sick. He's very healthy. And he may not be doing all those great, fantastic, supercalifragilisticexpialidocious. He may not be doing all those things, but he's still powerful. He's still loving. He's still caring. He's still answering prayer. And he may not be doing all the big things we want him to do, but he's doing some good things. And he can do great things if we'll just get on the bandwagon and follow along with his leadership. So he was taunted by the remembrance of better days. And then number four, he was absolutely overwhelmed by trials. Look at verse 7. Deep calleth unto deep at the noise of thy waterspouts, all thy waves and thy billows are gone over me. He's drowning. He's down in the depth. He's overwhelmed with depression. You know, some people say, well, the book of Job, that's a book of suffering. That's a book of being down in the depths and depression and everything. But the book of Job's not as much a book of suffering as it's a book of service. What will it take to get Job to quit serving you? That's what the devil wanted to do, was try and get Job to quit serving God. But Job said, though he slay me, I'll trust him. Yeah. I'm going to keep serving him. And the proposition of the book is, why does Job serve thee? Will he serve you when the trial is overwhelming? And what will it take to stop you from serving God?
That's right.
What trial will it get to get you drowning and down under? You know, I've had an evangelist friend commit suicide. I had a preacher friend that's over a mission board. His son committed suicide. Godly boy, valedictorian. Don't do it. And I mean, just a wonderful young man. But one day he got depressed. You say, why? His girlfriend went with another fellow. And she meant more than Jesus, evidently. And he hung himself. I know preachers have gone out in their front yard and took a gun and blew their brains out. While the family's inside, just had a family dinner. Overwhelmed by trials, depression. What will it take to get you to quit serving God? And then, not only was he absolutely overwhelmed by trials, he was upset with God's failure to answer his prayers. Look at verse 8. Yet the Lord will command his loving kindness in the daytime, and in the night his song shall be with me, and my prayer unto the God of my life. I will say unto God my rock, why hast thou forgotten me? Why go I mourning because of the oppression of the enemy? In one place he's praying, in the next place, why didn't you answer my prayer? Why'd you forget me? Sometimes people expect God to just jump when they do something. But he was upset with God's failure to answer his prayers quickly. George Mueller's mother prayed 25 years for George Mueller to be saved. She died and he wasn't saved. But her prayers got answered at the funeral. He got saved at her funeral. And then he became one of the greatest prayer warriors, the man that lived by faith and trusted God and prayed in millions of dollars in supplies to take care of orphans that became missionaries and pastors and evangelists and helped change the world. Just keep praying. Just keep praying. Just keep trusting. And then number 6, he was depressed by the attacks of the ungodly. Look at chapter 43 and verse 1. Judge me, O God, and please my cause against an ungodly nation. O deliver me from the deceitful and unjust man. He said, deliver me. You know, we live in a land where the queer's on the increase and television is just promoting them, and this gay marriage and homosexuals, lesbians, and they're just trying to force them down our throats on radio, television, everywhere you look. And sometime I go into some of these big cities and other places, and you see them holding hands and make it out in public. It just makes you sick. And we've got the ACLU, American Civil Liberties Union. They're against any liberty that Christians want to have for Christ. They're against anything that's godly and conservative and right. And then we've got even the government working against us. Hillary said the other day when she's president, she's going to change what religion can and cannot do. She's not going to allow you to preach against homosexuals. That's what she wants to do. She's going to change some things about religion and what religion can do. Yeah, the government wants to change a lot. Obama's done too much changing already. And here's this fellow. He's got all these things going against him, and he's depressed. But what do you do to get out of the depression? What did he do? Look at chapter 42 and verse 11. Why art thou cast down, O my soul, and why art thou disquieted within me? Hope thou in God.
Yes.
He took inventory of himself, and he shook himself, and he said, why am I here? I need to put my hope in God instead of my circumstances and what's around me. I need to put my hope in God.
Yes.
And that's what we need to do. Put our hope in God, shake ourselves from our self-pity, and just put your hope there. You know, five times they've gave me a short time to live. Four times I've almost died. And it just seemed, I remember back when I was 33 and I'd preaching for Dr. Lee Robertson at Highland Park in Chattanooga as the missionary featured in his conference. And I fell up the stairs. They got big stairs there. And I fell up and down. And he came to me and said, Bob, you're not clumsy. He said, you were a good athlete. He said, I don't know what the problem is, but I'm going to call Dr. Keene, who was my pastor at the time. He said, I want him to get the best orthopedic surgeon to check you out. So Dr. Frank Noyce was that research surgeon, that tremendous surgeon. They come from all over the world to him, all these professional athletes with every kind of sport and Olympics you can think of. And I've met all kind of fellas there and got to witness to them. But I went to him and he examined me and he said, you know, they used you as a guinea pig for steroids in your early teens. And he said, they gave you mega doses of anabolic steroids. And those steroids are going to cause you to be operated on till you die. And I laughed. I thought, sure, I'm going to be operated on till I die. I'm not laughing anymore because it seems like that's true. But I found out that there's hope in God.
Yes, it is.
There's hope in God.
Praise
and I don't have to be down in the dumps. I don't have to be discouraged about upcoming surgeries. I can be encouraged because I've got a God where there's great hope, and he'll go with me wherever I go. He promised never to leave me nor forsake me. And then he challenged himself to do what he should have been doing all along. Look at the next part of that verse. For I shall yet praise him. He challenged himself to do what he should have been doing all along, praising God, praising God.
Yeah.
You know, the God inhabits the praises of his people.
Sure does.
And when you're praising, God's present. And we ought to be praising God instead of down in the dumps and looking at all the rotten things that are going on around us. And then he reminded himself of a great certainty. Look at the latter part of the verse. Who is the health? God is the health of my countenance and my God. He's the health of my countenance. He's the one that puts a smile on our face.
That's right.
He's the one that keeps us up.
That's right.
He's the one that keeps us from being like this and makes us like this, you know. And it's God, this great God that we serve. He's the health of our countenance. And then let me close with this. He knew where proper guidance came from. Look at chapter 43 and verse 3. Oh, send out thy light and thy truth. Let them lead me. Let them bring me unto thy holy hill and unto thy tabernacles. It's the Word of God that was going to bring him back into the relationship with the Lord that he ought to have. And send out thy light and thy truth. That's what we're trying to do in the Bearing Press Seed Works. Send the light and the truth all over the world. But you know, you're to be lights in the world. And you're to take God's truth out there every day. And you're to help get the truth all over the world. Through this mission program of your church. And what a privilege. We don't have to be distressed. We don't have to be discouraged. We don't have to be despondent. We don't have to be down like this fella. We can be in the will of God. We can hope in God. And we can praise him. And we can let him change our countenance. And we can be filled with the Spirit of God. And we can be in the Word of God and get our lives changed for the best. My car broke down in Tennessee. And I'd been driving all night, and I was in this church, and they didn't give me a love offering or anything. And I just barely had enough money to get home. I didn't have money for food. I didn't had enough for gas to get home. And all at once, the car breaks down. I pull off the road and pull into a little station there. And there's a little motel up on the hill and a little restaurant in front of it. And then this greasy, nasty station. And I pulled in, and he said, well, we'll look at it for you. And they looked at it, and he said, yeah, it's going to take a few parts. It might take a couple of days to get them out here on the Appalachian Trail here. And I said, oh, boy. I said, you can't get them any sooner? He said, probably not. So I slept in my car, and I didn't eat. I just fasted and prayed and all, and they'd come over to the car and said, don't you want to buy something? Don't you want to go up there and eat? Wouldn't you rather stay in a motel? I said, no, my car sleeps fine. I'm doing great. And finally, you know, I said, Lord, I don't know how I'm going to get out of this situation. I don't have money to pay for it when the parts come and they fix it. And I don't know what I'm going to do. But I trust you. My hope's in you. My confidence is in you. It's not in me and my circumstances. I'm going to trust you with all my heart. And finally, they said, your car is fixed. I said, how much is it? He said, it's not going to cost a thing. Said, a fella just came in and paid for it. And I said, what fella? He said, it's strange. I've never seen him before in my life. Said, he just came up. He came in this dark black car. And he said he got out and said, you couldn't make out his face. It was like just kind of some funny thing there. And he said, he gave me the money. He didn't even ask how much it cost. He gave me exactly what it cost and left. Wow. He said, I never seen anything like it. And I thought to myself, well, I didn't have the money, but God sent an angel unaware to take care of things. And you know what?
Woo!
God can send angels to help you too. And sometimes the angels may be somebody right close to you, right around you. Somebody that just loves you. Don't get down. Get up. If you're having problems, if you're going through it, just like this young missionary couple, she just lost her mom. It's a hard time. But hope in God. He's the health of our countenance and our God. And praise our God. Now, Father, I pray you'd bless as Brother Baker comes and closes the service. Lord, we all have those times that the devil tries to sift us as wheat and tries to get us down and depressed and discouraged, and he'll get us to quit if he can. But Lord, we need to keep going. And sometimes we think, I can't take part in giving to missions. And the devil would trick us into thinking we're okay without participating. But I've seen God do some things with nothing. And here the widow, she gave her mite. She gave more than all those rich people because she cast in all her living. And God blessed her for it. Lord, may we give and may we live in light of thy love and share it with a world that needs it. Now, Lord, help us to be up and not down. Help us to allow you to work in our hearts and lives. And even when we're going through hell and high water, we can be a help to other people in the midst of our own need of help from you. So help us to allow that to happen as you work through us in Jesus' name. Amen. Pastor.
I need not say anything else as to stand our feet. Hope in God. That's it right there. Where's your hope today? Place where you work, your mom or dad, a neighbor, good friend. Amen. As the musicians play, you just do what God tells you to do. If you need to be saved, we can take the Bible and show you how you can be saved. If you want to come, spend some time in prayer. Come on right now. Make a visit to the altar. Come on. You don't have to face things alone. There's a God you can hope in, trust in, believe in. Stories that he tells. You can have some of that in your life too, you know. You really can. It's good to see these kids come in to pray. That message was. You enjoy that? Sure touched my heart. All right, you can be seated. Brian's going to come. He'll lead you in a couple of songs while we get ready for the baptism. We'll take just a couple of minutes and we'll get that done. All right, come on, Brother Brian, lead him in a song.
All right, let's turn right there to page number one. Page number one, and you can remain seated.
Sinner, condemned, unclean. Oh, I'm all. it's nice and warm, isn't it?
Huh?
Well, it wasn't long ago. Well, just a few weeks ago, her mother got saved and her sister got saved. Now she's gotten saved. And we thank God in it. Amen? You want to say anything? You don't want to say anything. That is a miracle. Here's a female that doesn't want to say anything. Obedience to the command of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, I baptize thee, my sister, in the name of the Father, in the name of the Son, in the name of the Holy Ghost, buried in the likeness of his death, and raised in the likeness of his resurrection. Amen. Let's give her a big hand. All right. Now, the greatest thing ever happened to somebody is getting saved. And use that first step of making it really public is making it public verbally and then getting baptized, because it tells the whole world. It's a picture of dead to an old life, up a new life, and then the resurrection too, the Lord Jesus Christ. And so if you've been saved, not been baptized, you need to get that taken care of. Amen? All right. Well, let's stand to our feet. We'll be dismissed in prayer. All right? All right. Brother Denny Farrell, would you dismiss us?